أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف المرسلين سيدنا ونبينا وحبيبنا ومولانا محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم قال الله تعالى في شان حبيب إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد وعلى آل سيدنا محمد وأصحابه وبارك وسلم. In the name of Almighty Allah, most merciful, most compassionate. Salutations upon the most honored, the most favored, and the most perfect of Almighty Allah's creation, the Holy Prophet Muhammad Mustafa sallallahu alaihi wasallam, his family, his companions and their families, after which to the members of the ulama, the elders in the masjid, ladies and gentlemen, members of the youth, as well as all those following us on the various social media platforms. I greet you. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi ta'ala wa barakatuh. First and foremost, we thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for giving all of us the opportunity of witnessing another Jummah, inshallah. And secondly, for me to be able to present this talk, I thank my Creator. Also, I thank the Imams, Sheikh Abdul Rahman and Sheikh Ismail, for the invitation to deliver this talk here today. As you've heard, Jamaat, the topic is the rise and decline of Muslim empires. This, of course, is the sequel to the trip that 37 of us did to two countries, namely Morocco and Spain. The talk today is not about a holiday as such. Although the holiday in itself, alhamdulillah, was a wonderful experience, but the talk is more about the state of the Ummah, very importantly, what we were, and unfortunately, what we are today. And as I'm talking to you, it reminds me of a very beautiful saying in one of the Eastern languages. And the saying is that when the frog, a small little frog, when the frog is in the well, the frog thinks that is the sum total of the world. Until the frog jumps out of the well and realizes really how huge the world is. And these trips which the masjid does basically is to bring about benefit for people to be able to see the world and to see the bigger picture. Morocco, 97% of the people are Muslims. Most of them, I would say 98% of the 97% are followers of the Maliki Madhab, founded by a personality by the name of Maulana Idris I. And important that in the times we're living in this country, it's important to mention that Maulana Idris himself was an immigrant, a direct descendant of your and my Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Maulana Idris I was the great, great, great grandson of our beloved Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Jamaat, the intention today is to give you a very balanced view of this trip. By balance, I mean, as I go along, you will notice that there are many highlights, but unfortunately, there are lowlights as well. For example, when we went to the city of Casablanca, the city on the seaside, we visited the iconic King Hassan II Mosque, very big, beautiful, ornate, indeed a marvel of architecture. Built in 1993, that's 26 years ago, and then this project, this masjid, costed $750 million. Sheer opulence. The minaret is 210 meters high. That's approximately 70 stories high. It is the largest masjid in Africa and the third largest in the world. What is very interesting is that a portion of the masjid is built over the ocean. And the current king's father, King Hassan, it is said, was inspired by one of the ayats in the Holy Quran, Surah Hud, verse number 7. And the English translation is Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. He it is who created the heavens and the earth in 6 days and declared his throne over the water. We had the fortune of performing Maghrib at that masjid. As I said, the talk is a very balanced one. We had the fortune, but the unfortunate experience of only seeing in that huge mosque, 2 safs for Maghrib, and very few young people. On the other hand, we were told that during the month of Ramadan, the mosque is packed to capacity, particularly over the last 10 days of Ramadan, where more than 100,000 people converge at that mosque for Taraweeh Salah. We proceeded to another city called Marrakesh, a very beautiful city, visited, among many other places, the Bahia Palace, known as the Palace of Brilliance, again a 19th century marvel. Again, we performed Maghrib. And this time around, the other side of the balance, the wudu facilities were absolutely pathetic. And this seems to be a worldwide issue. Wherever, and I say this with a lot of respect, wherever we find a concentration of Muslims, halal food seems to be no problem whatsoever. Hygiene seems to be a huge problem. We proceeded to another city called Fez, F-E-Z, which is the spiritual capital of Morocco. Here, among many other places, I think you'll find interesting, we visited the University of Karawin. According to the United Nations, UNESCO, it is the longest running university in the world, both in the Muslim world and in the non-Muslim world. And you will find it interesting, by the way, that this university, the longest running in the world, was founded by a woman by the name of Fatima Al-Fikhri way back in the year 1859. Fez also, I personally valued the mahabbah, the love, and the support which the people of Fez give for each other. And I just want to give you an example. We were shopping in the shopping area, and at the end of the shopping experience, I had to pay the bill, and I presented a credit card. That particular shopkeeper did not have a credit card machine. So within the wink of an eyelid, another shopkeeper, a couple of shops further down, comes to his aid. He couldn't help him. He takes the second shopkeeper, takes him to a third shopkeeper. That shopkeeper's machine was faulty. The third shopkeeper then takes me along to a point where there are a number of ATM machines. He then sees that I successfully concluded my transaction by drawing the cash. He escorts me, the third shopkeeper, escorts me back to the first shopkeeper, sees that I've paid the account for the first shopkeeper. They greet each other, they embrace each other, and the third shopkeeper goes back to his business. In South Africa today, we would have said, that's not my business, therefore it's not my business. Morocco has 50,000 mosques spread all over the country. Unfortunately, the main mosques, the iconic mosques, are all heavily regulated, are only open during the waqtus, and sometimes when there is a demand from the tourism industry, the mosques, unfortunately, are then open. As we left Morocco, we made a dua. I certainly did. May Almighty Allah bless the people of Morocco. A very modern, very clean, very spiritual, very friendly people, a proud nation. Some of us who follow football, we know how proud they are when they are on the soccer field. And above all that, Jamaat, a Muslim African nation. When you are there, you don't realize that you are still in Africa. And then we crossed the ferry, we crossed the Straits of Gibraltar from Morocco into Spain. And we faced a very, very sad reality. Just by way of background, after Hijrah, the rapid spread of Islam from Medina to places like Jordan, Syria, Iraq, India, Turkey, Sudan, Egypt, and Morocco. Historians have recorded that to be the unprecedented and remarkable phenomenon in history, unequaled by anyone else. Islam came to Spain in the early 7th century. And here is the crunch line. Muslims ruled Spain and part of Portugal for almost 1,000 years. It is considered to be the peak of human civilization. Thousands of mosques, street lamps, when the rest of Europe had no lamps at all, they were in darkness. Paved roads when the rest of Europe wouldn't even know where to walk. Hospitals treating sick people when the rest of Europe's people were dying of illness. Libraries, thousands of libraries, when the rest of Europe didn't even know how to read. Water reticulation systems, which is the marvel today of engineers today. Spain was considered to be the international center for knowledge. Darul Ulooms, not today, unfortunately, in the narrowest context of the word, but Darul Ulooms, which included Islamic knowledge, as well as the knowledge of science, geography, physics, mathematics, literature, and the arts. And while the West was wearing goatskin, our Muslim brothers and sisters in that 1,000-year period were wearing silk. Religion, culture, and tradition lived side by side, like we used to live in the Bukab, District 6. Jamaat, it is very great to talk about all these things. But the question that we need to ask each other, very frankly and very candidly, is what went wrong? Why did we mess it all up? The sad visit to the Alhambra in Granada, the architecture on the walls is a living testimony to the Muslim influence, today obliterated into history. Then we went to Cordoba. Cordoba, at the time, had the second largest masjid in the world, second only to the Haram Sharif, accommodating more than 45,000 people. When we got there, instead of hearing the Adhan, we heard church bells. It is today called the Cathedral Mosque. As the 37 South African Cape Townians walked around with very sad and heavy hearts to see what it was and what it is, I asked the guide who was taking us around. We all had our own headsets so we could follow the guide at a very personal level. I asked her whether I could take the microphone. And as we came to the original mihrab, which is still there today, I asked the 36 people with me in Afrikaans to make a dua. And I would like you to echo that dua here today. May Almighty Allah revert the status of that cathedral back to a mosque, inshallah. I asked the question once again, what went wrong? The lessons are many, but the important point is that we need to take stock of the situation and admit what has gone wrong. Like the Mughal Empire in India, that empire ruled India for more than 800 years. The Ottoman Empire, the British Empire, when the British were so haughty that they said the sun never set on the British Empire. When the sun rose on the one side, it set on the other side. The American Empire, as we know today, led by Mr. Trump himself. In our very own country, the white supremacist empire led up to 1994. At the moment, we have the Saudi Empire, and the worst empire of the whole lot is the Zionist Empire. What they should realize, nothing lasts, and that is the reality of life. But Jamaat, Almighty Allah is amazing. Almighty Allah is amazing. For in spite of all the sadness that we experienced on a very happy holiday, and I needed to balance that out, in spite of all the sadness which we experienced on a very happy holiday, we came across a beautiful WhatsApp clip which said that just a little bit further down in the United Kingdom, 500 churches became mosques over the last couple of years. And more happy for us than even that was the news we got that here in Cape Town, Gordon's Bay, after a 5-year struggle, got permission to establish a masjid where the tawheed to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will be established. The lessons out of all this, to conclude, first and foremost, the lessons for our young people here today. Remember, you are either the best or the worst ambassador of Islam. Whether you're at school, whether you're at university, other people are watching you and watching your conduct. And it is in the simplicity of your conduct that you will be able to make the most profound impact upon people who are not followers of the Deen. To those young people who are at high school, at university, and inshallah will be graduating, do not stagnate with the power that wealth brings about for you. Remember, young people, when you qualify, many of you today, once you qualify, you get very good jobs, and alhamdulillah, through the grace and barakah of Almighty Allah, you earn very well. Do not stagnate with the power that wealth brings upon you. Do not follow the path of some people who have betrayed our struggle in this country, opted for money, and have become multi-billionaires in the process. That only leads to destruction. For remember that Almighty Allah gives you in abundance what you like. Almighty Allah, listen to this very carefully, gives you in abundance what you like. Somewhere along the line, He takes away something that you love the most. Be very careful of that. He gives you in abundance what you like, but somewhere along the line, He takes away something which you love the most. And the answer to this vexing problem of the demise of these great empires, particularly the Muslim empires, and how sad it is for us as Muslims to be able to witness it, the answer couldn't come from me, Jamaat. The answer came from one of the greatest thinkers that Islam has ever produced, Imam Al-Ghazali. And I want you to listen to this very carefully. When Imam Al-Ghazali says, if you want to remain victorious on the road of life, emphasis on the word remain. If you want to remain victorious on the road of life, declare your jihad on 13 unseen enemies in your life. If you want to remain victorious on the road of life, declare your jihad on 13 unseen enemies in your life. What are those unseen enemies? The first enemy is egoism. The second, arrogance. The third, conceit. The fourth, selfishness. The fifth, greed. The sixth, lust. The seventh, intolerance. The eighth, anger. The ninth, lying. The tenth, cheating. The 11th, gossiping. The 12th, backbiting. And the last one is slandering. These are precisely the reasons why all these empires were reduced to dust. Sometimes the Trumps of the world and the Netanyahu's of the world feel that they've got all the gunpowder in the world, but they fail to realize that the gunpowder eventually becomes dust, becomes powder. With that, Jamaat, I really want to thank all those people that were with us. For 2 weeks we were together. It was a really wonderful experience. And I want to just reiterate that it was a wonderful, happy, spiritual holiday. We saw many, many things which I could not even cover in the talk. But at the end of the day, we need to strike the balance between what we were and unfortunately what we are. Shukran. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi ta'ala wa barakatuh.